an historic mosque in Timbuktu, on the edge of the Sahara Desert in the remote north of Mali, West Africa. It's a beautiful, magical setting. But today, Timbuktu remains traumatized after a 10-month occupation in 2012 by Islamic militants tied to Al-Qaeda. French and Malian forces drove them out, but the jihadists continue to threaten the area. It's the latest twist in the storied history of this city.
For the Western world, Timbuktu was long thought to be the very ends of the earth, a fabled city of gold made wealthy from desert caravans. Less well known, though, is that this was long a place of scholarship and learning.
But that legacy now lives here in Mali's capital of Bamako. In these pages from a collection of more than 400,000 manuscripts, most of them written between the 14th and 16th centuries. Arabic writings on science, philosophy, poetry, and more. Collectively, it's a priceless record of Islamic and African history, from a time when Timbuktu was home to a major university and was a center of learning.
Me, I'm the guardian of the manuscripts. I love all the manuscripts.
Yeah, like children.
Like children.
Timbuktu native Dr. Abdul Qadir Haidara, whose family has owned some of the manuscripts for generations, is now custodian of the entire collection.
There are subjects in them that are very, very important, that even today could help the world to resolve a lot of problems.
When jihadists invaded Timbuktu and set about to destroy many of its cultural treasures, it was Haidara who organized a rescue mission, smuggling the great majority of the manuscripts 400 miles over land and by boat to safety in Bamako.
This was very dangerous work, right?
At the time, it was very dangerous, because in the north there were many problems. There were jihadists, there were rebels, there were bandits. And also in the south at the time, there was a coup d'etat. So it was very dangerous throughout Mali at the time.
10,000 manuscripts remained in a large library built in 2009 to house and study them. Some were burned by the rebels in a final act of barbarism, and 2 years later, the charred pages remain. Luckily, though, the jihadists never looked in the basement where the most valuable manuscripts were hidden.
We have more than 10,000 manuscripts inside. They didn't touch them.
Really? So that was the miracle, 10,000 and they didn't touch them?
They didn't touch them.
Written on parchment paper, the manuscripts are fragile. Their worst enemy now is the humidity in Bamako. The process of restoring them is painstaking, involving careful cleaning and placement in acid-free, specially crafted boxes. Page by page, the team is also creating a digital inventory. The goal, to save the manuscripts and allow eager scholars around the world to study this wealth of material.
Jurisprudence.
Abdul Qadir Haidara cited a 19th century work about religious tolerance as an example of something that could have an impact today.
Today we have a lot of problems, a lot. So in my opinion, if we take out these manuscripts, the ones about good governance, and translate them, develop them, publicize them, I think that would help us with today's reality.
The manuscript project, in fact, is just part of a larger effort to revive Timbuktu and its people.
Some people say everywhere you go in the world, when you are native of Timbuktu, you always come back.
Salem Old El Haj is a blogger and freelance journalist who stayed in his hometown during the occupation. He said that while Timbuktu is known to the world as the end of the earth, for him, it is a beginning, one that can have a vibrant future.
A place of melting pot.
A melting pot.
A melting pot where you can find all kind of different ethnic living together.
Timbuktu might become a crossroads again. The UN's cultural agency is reconstructing sacred tombs that were smashed to pieces by jihadists.
La Grande Université de Tombouctou.
And as unlikely as it seems now, there are plans to build a new university in the desert. And an international initiative called the Timbuktu Renaissance is raising awareness of the city's plight through music and cultural events. Jai Ramatulai Jallo is Mali's culture minister.
all Malians are really counting on culture to use a crucial role in this peace process. Mali is definitely a poor country when it comes to the budget, but when it comes to civilization, culture, and dignity, Mali is a very rich country.
Maria Arbi, known as the Nightingale of the Desert, is a musician who faced death threats in Timbuktu and fled to Bamako with her family. She hopes to return sometime soon, she told us. For now, from her rooftop, Arbi sang a traditional Timbuktu song, both a lament for and a celebration of her homeland. From the West African nation of Mali, I'm Jeffrey Brown for the PBS NewsHour.